Welcome to the 700 Club, reopening the country and rebooting the economy. That's the focus of the president, and he's ready to phase out the coronavirus task force.
Reopening comes with risks. A new model projects a significant increase in deaths from the virus over the summer. Caitlin Burke reports.
President Trump says it's time for the focus of the country to shift. His administration now working to get the economy back up and running while also protecting people.
So I think that as far as the task force, Mike Pence and the task force have done a great job, but we're now looking at a little bit of a different form, and that form is safety and opening, and we'll have a different group probably set up for that.
Administration officials say the task force will probably end in late May or early June, but Drs. Birx and Fauci will continue to advise the president.
It's the balance of something that's a very difficult choice, like how many deaths and how much suffering are you willing to accept to get back to what you want to be some form of normality sooner rather than later?
Some 38 states are now in the process of reopening. Among those, COVID cases are on the rise in at least 19 of them. A model from the University of Washington predicts the number of deaths could increase to nearly 135,000 by the beginning of August. Still, in an exclusive interview with ABC News, the president questioned the accuracy of that kind of model and expressed confidence in his decision to move forward with reopening.
We're going to practice social distancing. We're going to be washing hands. We're going to be doing a lot of the things that we've learned to do over the last period of time. And we have to get our country back.
Trump toured a Honeywell factory in Arizona that's now making N95 masks, his first trip outside of Washington since March. During that exclusive interview with ABC News, he expressed sympathy for the families who have lost someone to the virus and encouraged the elderly to continue to take extra precautions.
I want to say I love you. I want to say that we're doing everything we can. I also want to say that we're trying to protect people over 60 years old. We're trying so hard. And everything I've said today, I'd like to preface it by saying, if you're 60 years old, and especially if you're 60 or even less than that, and you've had a heart condition or you've had diabetes or a problem of any kind, it seeks out problems. This is a vicious, it seeks out weakness in terms of medical.
Trump also cited progress on the administration's push to have a vaccine ready by the end of the year. As to opening the economy and getting people back to work, the president predicted a turnaround and a strong third quarter. Caitlin Burke, CBN News.
Well, CBN News chief political analyst David Brody joins us now from Washington. David, how do you rate the president's performance so far with the coronavirus?
Well, I think it's a mixed bag, Gordon, quite frankly. And look, the polling showing that there are a lot of Americans, a majority of Americans, concerned about this phased reopening. Sure, you see the protests in certain states, and sure, some governors say it's time, and of course, the president's saying it's time. But look, this is a huge gamble, Gordon, by the president. I don't think there's any question about it. As a matter of fact, I was talking to Corey Lewandowski, the former Trump campaign manager in 2016, now a senior advisor to the 2020 campaign. And he said to me just yesterday, we were talking on the phone, and he said, look, David, this is a huge gamble by the president, because if this comes back after a phased reopening, this would be a major threat to a second term for this president. So, look, even Donald Trump admits it's a bit of a gamble. But he's willing to do that. And why is he willing to do it, Gordon? Look, I think it kind of goes back to a pastor that he knows very well called one of the best speakers he's heard of all time, Pastor Norman Vincent Peale, who talked about the power of positive thinking. As a matter of fact, I was looking this morning at some quotes that Donald Trump had said about positivity and optimism, and here's a couple. He says, if you're going to be thinking, you might as well think big. And then he said, always think positively and expect the best. And I think that's what we're seeing from this president right now. It's still a gamble, though.
Well, isn't he trying to essentially take back his major campaign plank, which is the strong economy? That was such a plus for him. And now we're looking at a tattered economy. How is that campaign message going to play out?
Well, it's interesting you bring that up, because going into the campaign 4 or 5 months ago or so, it was keep America great. Now, in a way, it's starting to morph into make America great again again. And I think that's what we're seeing here, Gordon. Look, you've got 30 million folks unemployed, unemployment north of 19%. And Corey Lewandowski also telling me, saying, look, he's a political guy, and he says those are just not good numbers. And yes, the American people will give him a pass on the numbers. But at some point, you know, if this doesn't turn around soon, especially in the third quarter, this will be on the president's watch. And ultimately, how he responds to this is going to be crucial here, Gordon.
Well, let's turn to the other side, Joe Biden and his sexual assault charges. And I've got to bring up Kavanaugh. Are we dealing with a double standard here?
Well, I think that's obviously what you're going to hear from the critics who say, well, wait a minute, Me Too movement. You talked a lot about that during Donald Trump and some of what we heard in 2016. Where are you now? And I think the only logical conclusion is that folks in the Me Too movement obviously find that to be very important, but they find defeating Donald Trump to be even more important. And I think so clearly this is political as well. And that's what's been going on. I think Joe Biden actually has made this a whole lot worse for himself in that interview, and that very good interview with Mika Brzezinski. And I mean good, not with Joe Biden, but what Mika Brzezinski did. I mean, she had a very, very tough interview with him. And Biden made it worse by basically saying, I don't want anybody to see those records at the University of Delaware. And then he makes the point that a lot of things can be brought up that have nothing to do with Tara Reid if they go into those University of Delaware documents. And then Mika Brzezinski said, well, wait a minute, why don't we just do a search for the Tara Reid documents? And he didn't have an answer for that. Look, he's talking about transparency, and he's doing a bit of a lack thereof. And let's remember, this is Joe Biden who came out and said at the beginning of his run for president that he was running for president, in essence, to restore a morality, if you will, back to the presidency. Well, hard to do that and then run against these allegations as well. That's going to be some tough sledding ahead for Joe Biden.
Well, let's talk about the campaign. Are we going to see the first time in, I think, in American history, that there's no political conventions?
Yeah, no, I think we're going to see a form of that for sure. I don't think there's any way, Gordon, at this point, at least the sources that I'm talking to, that there's going to be any sort of natural political convention. Definitely not for the Democrats. Republicans are still holding out hope that they will, and with Donald Trump being unconventional, he'll probably want to hold the convention and show strength and toughness. So we'll see. But either way, we are going to have an asterisk campaign in 2020, and that means conventions not the way we would normally see them. Clearly campaigning not the way we normally would see it as well. Joe Biden essentially campaigning out of his basement, doing virtual town halls, and Donald Trump slowly but surely getting back to those rallies. But even with those rallies, I mean, are you going to pack 20,000 people into an arena? I mean, I think we're going to see some social distancing at those rallies if and when they start again.
Well, I just can't imagine a rally with social distancing. It just doesn't make any sense. And, you know, we're looking at churches being shut down, and I just can't imagine it. It just doesn't make any sense to have any kind of political gathering. I'm even wondering, how in the world are we going to vote? How are we going to gather in a voting booth? Do I really want to go into a voting booth that other people have been in? You know, how do you disinfect it? How do you keep it safe? We're in for a pretty interesting ride all the way through this election. Well, David, thanks for your insights.
You bet, Gordon. Thank you.
In other news, the Western Wall is open again to visitors as Israel begins lifting one of the world's most stringent lockdowns. John Jessup has more on that story from our CBN News Bureau in Washington. John?
Thanks, Gordon. Like here in the United States, Israel's economy flatlined and unemployment skyrocketed. But now that the number of new infections has dropped, the country is cautiously starting to reopen. CBN Middle East Bureau Chief Chris Mitchell has the details.
Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu announced the move, saying Israel had fought the coronavirus well.
One of the most visible symbols affected by the announcement is here at the Western Wall. The holy site is now open for general prayer, but people are instructed to pray in designated areas so they can practice social distancing.
Netanyahu also laid out a timetable that would allow Israelis to return to a more normal life by the middle of June.
It's permitted to visit your close family members. It's permitted to visit grandpa and grandma. But I'm asking you still, don't hug, don't kiss, and don't touch.
In addition to dropping the travel restriction, the announcement includes immediately opening certain businesses, including libraries, hotels, and nature reserves. Then on Thursday, malls, gyms, and open-air markets can open, and gatherings of up to 20 people and weddings with up to 50 guests will be permitted. Israelis must still wear masks in public and practice social distancing. Children in grades 1 to 3 and 11 and 12 also return to school this week. The first wave of openings included salons. Salon owner Yaniv Hofi was elated to finally open his doors.
It's wonderful. We waited a long, long time to be here, and it's fun. It's a bit hard to put on the mask all the time.
Yeah.
You see? But it's better than nothing, so.
Natalie Cohen had challenges adjusting to her new equipment.
It's not easy. I don't have any air. I'm like this from the morning. But I'm okay, praise God. We have work. That's the most important thing.
Israel's unemployment has skyrocketed to 26% as the economy slowed to a crawl. Yaniv said it's about more than just the business.
It's fun. Everybody's happy to be here. So I enjoy not only the walk, also to meet the people.
Chris Mitchell, CBN News, Jerusalem.
Thanks, Chris. Thursday marks the annual National Day of Prayer. Like the rest of the country, it's going to look a lot different this year. In the past, people have come together nationwide in more than 60,000 local events to pray for America. This year, organizers plan to hold virtual events online, giving it the potential to become the largest prayer gathering in American history, with millions interceding for the nation. And Thursday night features a special National Day of Prayer event from 8 to 10 Eastern. You can watch it live on the CBN News channel, as well as CBNNews.com, our CBN apps, and YouTube. Gordon, if there was ever a time we needed prayer, it sure is now.
I think lots of people have been praying, and it's great that we're having a National Day of Prayer. We can focus together. Again, that's tomorrow night, Thursday night, 8 p.m., it's available on all the CBN apps as well as YouTube. So make plans to not just watch, but also participate. We all need to pray. This is a desperate time for the nation. We face some problems that we literally haven't seen before in our history. And how do we move forward? We need God. We need His guidance. We need His wisdom.